Exam day. This is everything you've been preparing for. This is where you actually prove that you have the knowledge and you understand the way that IC squared is asking the questions. Answer everything from the right point of view. Your risk advisor and IT security manager answer it as if you were a lawyer. Answer exactly what they ask. And hopefully you'll pass your certification. Having mental clarity on this day is extremely important. You need to make sure you go to bed early, and it's also smart to book the exam in your peak hours. Peak hours is the time of day when you are most productive, you're clearest, and depending on who you are, you know when that is. Some people wake up in the morning and they're just ready to go. They've had a good night's sleep, their brain is functioning. If you're that person, well then book it as early as you can. If you're the kind of person that needs to wake up, get some coffee, and a couple of hours later, you're good to go. Well then book the certification later. You know when you're going to be clearest and best. So book the exam for that time and get plenty of sleep the night before. Don't cram all the way up till past midnight, get a couple of hours of sleep, and then go for it. You just worsened your chance of passing. You also know how many hours of sleep your body needs to feel rested. Then get that and then a little more. I have students that study on the day of the test, and I have some that don't. If you at this point are not ready, well then you probably should have rescheduled the exam. If you are studying on exam day, maybe do 5 or 10 questions, no more, just to get your brain in the right mindset. And the reason I say don't study on exam day is it wears your brain out, and you very much need that for the actual exam. So let's take an example of Bob. Bob has been studying for months. He is consistently scoring high on practice tests. He understands why the right answer is the right answer and why the wrong answers are wrong. He can explain the concepts. Bob is ready. He gets a good night of sleep before the exam, and Bob, being a morning person, he books the exam for 8 a.m. You need to arrive at the test center before your exam. Don't get surprised by traffic. And if you're more than 15 minutes late, they have the option to deny you taking the exam. You show up late, you lose your money. So be there early. Plan at least half an hour extra buffer in just in case traffic is bad. For Bob, the test center is 20 minutes away. To be in good time, he leaves at 7 o'clock. He arrives on time. Even though he's early, they allow him to check in when he arrives. Then there is the check-in process. They obviously have to confirm who you are. That means you need to bring 2 sets of IDs, and at least one of them have to have your picture on it. It has to be officially issued. That means your driver's license, your passports, your ID card, whatever you have where you live. The second set of ID doesn't necessarily have to have a picture on it, but it's better if it does. But you can bring things like credit cards or student IDs, whatever you have that can help prove who you are. Then your picture is taken, and you sign an agreement saying you're going to follow the exam outline, you're not going to cheat. Then they take all your belongings, they lock them in a little closet, a cupboard, or whatever they have. That is your phone, your keys, your wallet, anything you potentially could use to cheat on the exam. This also includes if you brought drinks or snacks or foods. Whatever you have with you outside of your clothes, your glasses, your shoes, that all gets locked away. Bob has his 2 sets of IDs, he has his picture taken, he signs the agreement. In many places, there's also some sort of biometric, fingerprint, palm scan, or whatever. The proctor locks Bob's stuff away and takes him to the exam room. You need to understand here, there might be 25 other people taking different certifications. The test center will most likely not be quiet. So if you're smart, ask them for headphones, either the little earbuds, the little foam ones you can put in your ears. And I've even been in test places where they had those big industrial earmuffs just so you can drown the sound out from the other students. I would very much suggest getting them, because other students are going to be coughing, they're going to have nervous tics, they're going to tap their pen on the table, they're going to be upset when they fail, or the exam engine doesn't do what it's supposed to. Drown as much as you can of that out. The CISP exam is proctored. Back in the day, that meant someone sat in the room and kept an eye on you the entire time. In most places, however, now, that has been replaced with video cameras. So if you need something, you need to take a break, you need to go to the bathroom, you want to eat a snack, you either raise your hand and they come and get you, or you go to the door exiting the exam room and they'll get you and escort you wherever you need to go. You cannot leave the building. You are allowed to go to the bathroom, get a drink, eat a snack, take a 5-minute break, whatever you need to reset your mind. But remember, just because you leave the exam room, the exam does not pause. If you choose to take half an hour break, you now have half an hour less for your exam. And I highly recommend taking the breaks, but make them as short and as efficient as you can. Go out, drink some caffeine, eat some sugar, clear your mind, and then go back to the test. If in your studying, you know when you're going to hit the wall. Let's say every time you take a full practice test, you know at hour and a half, you're going to hit the wall. Well, then maybe design it so on the exam, when you get to an hour and 15 minutes, you take a break. You avoid the wall. All right, back to Bob. Bob is in the testing center. The proctor starts the exam, and before the actual exam starts, you have 5 minutes where Pearson Liu is going to show you how the test works. This is how you click forward, this is how you click backwards, all the practical stuff. In those 5 minutes, you can, if you want, write down the mnemonics that you need, any formulas, whatever you think is relevant. That way, if after 120 questions, you don't remember the proper order of incident response, look on your pad. Thank you, passed you. But be very careful here. Keep an eye on the timer. You only have 5 minutes, and I've had students that forgot about it. They never clicked start exam before the 5 minutes were up. They were not allowed to test. They lost their exam fee. So Bob writes down his mnemonics, has his notes, and he clicks start exam. At this point, the 4-hour timer starts, and you have to answer between 125 and 175 questions. How many you get depends on how well you do. If at the point where you answer question number 125 and the certification back end can see with a high degree of certainty that you're either going to pass or fail, you will, well, pass or fail. If on the other hand, the engine can't tell yet, well, then you keep getting questions until it can. I have had many students who got to the last question and still passed the exam. So even if you get to 150 or 160, do not give up. Until you hit 175 and the exam ends, you have a chance. And regardless if you get the 125 or the 175, 50 of those questions are beta questions. They don't count towards your score. They are test questions that IC2 is testing out for future exams. See how well students score. You are only graded on between 75 and 125 questions, depending on how far your exam goes. And an important thing here. Not all questions are created equally. All questions are weighted on how difficult they are. A difficult question can be worth 8 points, where an easy question might only be 3 points. So in most cases, how difficult a question is equals how many points it's worth. But you still have no way of telling which questions are actual questions and which are the 50 beta questions. You just know that within the first 125 questions, 50 of those are not scored. The CISP exam is not open book. It's on a computer. And if you want, you can go to the Pearson Liu website and see examples of how the exam looks. The most common type of questions on the exam are multiple choice questions. You get one question and then you get 4 answer options, A, B, C, D. Then you pick the most right answer in this scenario from the right point of view. There will also be some scenario-based questions, which really also are multiple choice questions. With those, you can have between 2 and 5 questions based on the same scenario. We're in this company, this is what's going on, we're in this and this position, what should we do? And then those 2 to 5 questions is based on that one scenario. But here again, they are multiple choice questions. You may also get drag and drop questions. They will look something like this. You have a question, and then from the different answer options, you need to drag those into the right column or next to the right answer. And then you click next. And as the last question type, we have hotspot questions. You get a scenario with a question in it, and then you choose where on this diagram would we implement this solution, or where is this problem occurring. Both the hotspot and the drag and drop you may not even see on your exam. In most exams, 95% of the questions, at least, are just multiple choice questions, either themselves or the scenario-based ones. So the vast majority of questions is just A, B, C, D. The drag and drop questions can be up to 3% of the exam, and the hotspot about 2%. And I use about because there are no official numbers. It's just what I'm hearing back from students. Those are the ratios they're seeing them in. But again, many students say, I had no drag and drop, I had no hotspot. Just don't be surprised if your exam has them. And remember, the CISP question pool for the exam is huge. Supposedly, they have 10,000 plus questions, so on your specific exam, you might see entirely different weights of multiple choice, drag and drop, and hotspot, but the vast majority will be multiple choice. All right, back to Bob. Bob knows that after 1.5 hours, his brain is going to give out. So at 1 hour and 15 minutes, he takes his first break. He gets up, notifies the proctor, eats some candy, drinks some caffeine, goes to the bathroom, and 5 minutes later, he's back in the exam room. Now, since this is something Bob has practiced, he knows how to clear his mind, reset it, and he can start over. You can even just meditate. Close your eyes for 20 seconds, clear your mind, and then start on the next question. The CISP exam is both an English exam because of how they ask the questions, but it is also a marathon. Since it is a marathon, you need to find a way where you can reset your brain and actually start to function normally again once you hit the wall. When you're going to be done answering all the questions really depends on who you are, how quick you read, how prepared you are, and also, is English your first language? If you're taking a test in a language that's not your first language, it's going to take longer. I think when I did my CISP exam, I was done with my first pass of all the questions maybe at 4.5 hours, but back then it was also 250 questions and 6 hours. It just took me longer because English was not my first language. And then on top of that, I spend a good deal of time reading and rereading the questions because they can be tricky. All right, back to Bob. He has answered all the questions. He clicks end exam. Then he goes outside the test room to the nice proctor and gets his results. And obviously, what you want to see on those results is, congratulations, you passed. But keep in mind, the CISP is a very, very difficult exam. Many people don't pass on their first attempt or second or even third. But if you are one of those people, do not despair. While I passed my CISP certification on my first try, I have had other certifications where I failed multiple times. And that really is how you're going to be successful in life. It is how you react when you fail. How do you continue after that? Winning is easy, losing not so much. So in the next 2 sections, I will cover what you do when you fail and what you need to do when you pass, because you are not done yet. Thank you for being here. I will see you in those sections where we'll talk about what to do when you pass your exam and what to do when you fail.